a flame trench taking shape at Massey's, new tanks for Sanchez, office building footings at the build site, and a parking lot destroyed at the launch site. Welcome and thanks for stopping by for this week's Starbase Flyover Update Episode 33, brought to you by RGV Aerial Photography. I'm Jeff A, and I'll be your guide today as we check out the progress at SpaceX's facilities located at Starbase, Texas. The weather is wonderful, so sit back and enjoy the views from 10,500 feet. Alright, let's begin here at Massey's structural test site. Special shout out to Procky for creating these labelled maps for Starbase. Let's have a quick comparison from the last flyover on the 18th of February to the latest images taken on the 23rd. Starting off at the top right of the site, we can see significant progress has been made on what is speculated to be the business end of the static fire stand, with a U-shaped rebar cage with four embeds constructed. This is speculated to be the mounting point for a platform that the ship attaches to so the ship can be rolled on and off, eliminating the need for a crane or the two-point lifting jig. Here's a render of one possibility thanks to Chrome Kiwi. Moving left to the methane tank farm area, we can see new stands for what could be pipes on the right side, as well as additional pipework leading to the subcoolers. To the left, we can see three new tanks have arrived and placed here to get sandblasted and a fresh coat of paint. It appears that they will eventually be installed in this area just above the methane farm, where this rig is currently placing piles. These are water deluge tanks similar to the ones at the launch site and will be used for the flame trench during static fires. You might be thinking, why do these tanks look really rusty? Well, this is because they are from 1979. Near the LOX hippos, plumbing continues. The small gap left here will have expansion pieces seen nearby inserted. Further to the left, two more smaller pipes have been prepped to go also into the vaults under the roadway. Shifting down, we can see the speculated bucket for the flame trench has begun construction. Thanks to a render by Ryan Hansen Space, this is what the business end of the flame trench might look like. Moving to the new structural pad poured a few weeks ago, we can see it is receiving more concrete around the perimeter. Its purpose is still unknown. And with that, on to Sanchez. With the many changes at all the Starbase sites, it's extremely helpful to have these labelled maps from Procky to help us keep up to date. Starting off at the ground fabrication building, new racks have been placed here to keep everything in some sort of order. This is important because many pipes are being staged for Massey's and launch site tank farm work, and ahead of construction of the new orbital pad B. We'll talk more on that later. Moving right, at the stand construction area, there's been not much progress since the last flyover. It looks like they are not paying much attention to the new booster transport stands because they don't need them at the moment. The third ship engine installation stand is almost ready to be installed in Mega Bay 2. These two mystery items are, you guessed it, still a mystery. The flat one was speculated to be a hot stage ring stand, but since they covered the three clamp receivers, that idea is going away, and given the fact that there are pieces for at least more than one, is bringing some more speculation on what this thing could be. We will keep an eye out on that. The other one looks like it received a paint job, but not much progress since. A little further over, the star-shaped item has been moved away and the parts remain to make more. Moving up to the tower segment staging area, progress is still being made on the section being constructed, and we are still waiting for SpaceX to transport all five segments that have recently been delivered to the port of Brownsville. Drainage work is almost complete as most trenches have already been covered with dirt, and concrete soon to come. This is the last section still missing some piping and dirt. They should finish that work by next week. If we keep rolling up, we see the natural gas power plant with three Tesla megapacks have been transported from the former tracking station site at the village. If we go closer to Remedios Avenue, the new water tank has been completed being at its full height, and if we look closer, we can see the unused CO2 tank that was relocated from the launch site deluge farm. Also in this area, two new tanks are staged, with one lifted and placed into position onto the concrete in line with the vaporizers. The mounting holes were seen marked here on the concrete. The large tank was relocated from the nearby pedestals. We noticed the parking lots across the front of Sanchez have been used extensively as work continues on the new multi-level parking garage. Before we explore Star Factory and the new office building construction at the build site, refer to this labelled map made by Procky. First looking into Mega Bay 2, we can see that the ship engine installation ring has received its safety cages on the front as well as at the back. As the stand nears completion, we can expect another ship to have its engines installed any day now. Now looking at this angle view, we see that cladding has been removed on the bottom right of Mega Bay 2, and since this image was taken, steel was also removed all the way to the entrance. Could this be the future location of the Raptor storage area? In front of this bay, some heavy-duty staircase flights and rails have appeared, their destination still unclear. Over to the side, we can see the lifting jig and ship transport stands, which would indicate the S-29 would be moved soon, possibly to the rocket garden, but in an interesting turn of events, Ship 29 had its two-point ship lifter removed on Saturday the 24th, thanks to Vix for compiling this footage from Lab Padre's rover cam. The lifting rig was then reattached to S-29, and in the early hours of February 25th, it was removed from the maintenance stand. Panning down this image, we see the booster transport stand atop a pair of SPMTs. This stand was used to transport Booster 10 back from the launch site as it undergoes final launch preparations ahead of IFT-3. Now inside the megabay itself, Booster 10 currently sits on the centre booster engine installation stand with B-12 on its left and B-11 on its right. Booster 13 sits in the left front corner and Booster 14's LOX tank being stacked over on the right. Panning left of the high bay, Ship 30 and Ship 31 still sit on the back and front of the bay with no noticeable changes this week. These ships are scheduled to fly on Flight 5 and 6 with B-12 and 13 respectively. The newer S-32 was rolled back to the rocket garden a couple of weeks ago and will be the last version 1 Starship. Now let's move on to the Star Factory. The first thing we notice is that a fresh concrete pour was occurring at the time of the flyover, as seen by the telltale yellow vapour barriers as well as the concrete trucks on site. Now looking at the small wall being propped up for seemingly no reason, the area has been boxed in by roof framework and cladding, indicating it will not expand much further to the left or right. This essentially eliminates our previous theory that it will be for aesthetics, as a jagged roofline will only make Star Factory look even uglier. What do you think this wall in the middle of nowhere is for? In our last Star Factory update for this week, steel beams have once again started to be raised southwards after a month-long pause. Workers were likely awaiting a shipment of fresh steel columns, which arrived this week, seen by the loads of steel seen staged around the area. Now turning our attention to the area on the right side of Star Factory being used to create offices, we see some strange foundations in the works. Zooming in, we see three sets of dogbone-shaped foundations. The first one on the right was poured with concrete, and the workers on top give a sense of scale, showing just how tall and wide this footing really is. The foundation on the extreme left was currently being filled with rebar as we flew over. If the rebar were any thicker, the foundation would be solid steel. If you've watched Star Factory grow in past weeks, you'll know that even the bridge crane sections of the factory meant to carry heavy loads did not feature foundations as deep as this building. So, what use would SpaceX even have for this much weight in a building? It's possible the five-story office building will include wide atriums and a mezzanine for each level, or perhaps the first floor will be designated for manufacturing or test stations. Behind the Star Factory, the wall along the edge of the property continues towards the village. In this photo from the rear, we can see how the top finishes off level with previous sections. And over here, a small matter of interest is that we can see what looks to be the tracking camera has made a return. Before we get started at the launch site this week, let's take a look at the labelled map for those who may be unfamiliar with the layout. What a beautiful sight to see as we approach from 2 miles above Boca Chica Beach. We'll begin with the most obvious change at the suborbital site, the demolition of the employee and contractor parking lot. That's right, it appears concrete is the only material susceptible to removal shortly after it's poured at Starbase. It took crews just a few days to remove the asphalt after they began on February 21st. At least concrete and asphalt are easily recycled materials, right? At this point, you're probably wondering what gives. Well, we didn't have to wait long to find out the reasoning behind the decision. SpaceX has reinitiated their permit application to the US Army Corps of Engineers for site expansion plans. Originally filed in March 2021, the proposal was withdrawn just after 1 year, quote, to provide SpaceX time to develop an alternative analysis and public interest review necessary to complete our evaluation. The application was restarted on February 12th of this year, with confirmation that SpaceX is, quote, requesting to fill a 0.16-acre wetland to construct a second orbital launch pad, which will replace the current suborbital launch pad and test stand. The initial site expansion proposal would have impacted just over 17 acres of mudflats and wetlands, but with this revised proposal, only a small sliver of wetland wedged between two plots already approved for use is being sought after. Public comments on the matter are due by March 25th. So what might an orbital launch pad look like on this side of the site? This render by the space engineer gives you a rough idea of what we might see once it's all completed. How do you think the second pad will be orientated? Let me know your thoughts in the comments. While our dream of seeing two starships stacked side by side along the Boca Chica beachfront appears to be all but over, placing them one behind the other is likely the best path forward for SpaceX and the Artemis program. To achieve the necessary milestones due in the coming years, a much higher cadence of flights must be achieved as quickly as possible. So building the second pad mostly within the already approved launch site perimeter allows construction to begin much sooner, as the approval of the initially proposed 17-acre expansion could take 6 months or more, along with increased public scrutiny. Despite the existing suborbital site infrastructure, crews should be able to begin foundation work while they wait for ship testing activities to shift to masses. Speaking of ship testing, what's the latest with S28? After closures previously posted for 2 days last week were revoked, the ship continued to receive cosmetic work over the weekend. During the overnight hours following our flyover on the 23rd, S28 received its livery, just as the ships that came before it did prior to launch. Shout out to Starbase Surfer and X for capturing this photo on the 24th. Be sure to check him out at the link in the description below. Later that day, the two-point lifter for the ship was disconnected and laid down by the crane, since the stand was previously moved to the build site for other lifting operations. This likely signals the end of work inside the ship as preparations for another test campaign continue. With the lift jig now removed, crews untethered the aft and forward flaps to allow them to move freely. Some tile work to replace those previously damaged by the jig was also spotted. Another trio of closures was posted on the Cameron County website for the 26th through the 28th. The closure for the 26th was marked as scheduled over the weekend, making the other 2 days backup opportunities. The suborbital tank farm came to life just after 10 a.m. Starbase time, with frost lines developing on the ship just under an hour later. Engine chill began about an hour and a half after operations got underway, followed shortly by a spin prime of an unknown number of engines. For those of you that had the spin prime on your bingo card after last week's episode, this was your lucky day. The test didn't appear to be for all six engines, likely indicating a test of only the engines that received attention at the Sanchez site after the last rollback. While ship testing was underway, the orbital pad underwent testing of its own. Venting could be seen from the tank farm before the suborbital site was active, followed by venting from the OLM and launch tower. As the sun set on February 26th, two SBMTs with counterweights arrived at the launch site. The aft and forward flaps on S28 were also observed being tethered. This likely signals the end of the test campaign for the ship. Shifting our attention over to the orbital tank farm expansion, we see one of the new vaporizers has been delivered and placed next to the horizontal tanks temporarily. This arrived along with the four smaller vaporizers on the 21st. The two tanks we spotted being lifted in our last episode can also be seen nearby. On the newest concrete slab that lies at the end of the recently covered conduit trench, we see formwork in place for another concrete pour to support what is likely to be electrical transformers. Plumbing work continues along the front of the new horizontal tanks. Over beside the new large vaporizer, we can see what could be another support like those used under the platform built in front of the tanks, which currently spans just the first three. We expect this to run the length of all nine before it's all said and done. At the end of the orbital tank farm by the electrical bunker, a new transformer sits on the pad poured just a few weeks ago. Insulation work on the tank behind the bunker appears to be near completion as well. The concrete apron in front of the new blast wall is yet to be poured at the time of this photo, but the formwork appears to be mostly in place, with the possible exception of some additional rebar which can be seen in the lower right. In the former location of GSE-8, which was the converted water storage tank, we can see pedestals have been poured in the trenches that were spotted in our last episode. While we initially theorised vaporisers might be mounted here, it appears SpaceX has other plans. On Saturday, February 24th, Lab Padre's Rover 2 cam caught the arrival of these two horizontal storage tanks at the launch site. Special thanks to Vix on X for creating this clip. Check her out at the link in the description below. A vertical tank of similar size would also arrive on the 24th, with a third horizontal tank showing up the next day. One of these horizontal tanks was placed on and then removed from the new pedestals later that night. These are speculated by Zack Golden from CSI Starbase to supply water to the detonation suppression system for the OLM. The GMK7550 Grove crane can be seen already in position to assist with lifting the new tanks into place. The white tank over by the Deluge tank farm that arrived over a month ago was moved behind the orbital tank farm and lifted by the crane on the 24th, mounted vertically in the right rear corner of the pad next to the new pedestals. The additional vertical tank that arrived earlier the same day was placed next to it. Looking now at the OLM, the clamp alignment jig was seen in the centre once again. This is odd to say at the very least, considering the last round of testing with the full stack occurred just after alignment work was completed. The testing performed was mild in comparison to the full launch rehearsal. The return of the jig could be in relation to the realignment work seen on the chopsticks' upper and lower stabiliser points since this photo. The jig wouldn't hang around for long, however. The evening of the 27th, the booster transport stand was spotted heading towards Megabay 1. With a new transport closure in place between 5 and 8am Starbase time on the morning of the 28th, it was time for B-10 to return to the OLM. Overnight, in preparation of the impending lift, the Raptor QD and Booster QD ports were purged. Rollout occurred just before dawn on Wednesday. By mid-afternoon, B-10 was back on the OLM at last. Did you notice that lift in the back? That's right, S-28 was removed from the test stand at the same time B-10 was being lifted. S-28 later rolled between the chopsticks and was stacked ahead of the next round of testing to prepare for flight. Over at the water tank farm, we can see the former location of the unused vertical tank that was moved to the Sanchez site is now vacant. Lastly, we see the new concrete structure next to the water tank farm with all the formwork now removed, and what appears to be insulation just inside the opening that faces us. We'll end today's episode with some big news from SpaceX and the FAA. According to a post on X on February 26th from Washington Post space reporter Christian Davenport, the FAA has closed the mishap investigation into the second Starship flight test. A total of 17 corrective actions were listed in the report, 7 for the booster and 10 for the ship. SpaceX must now implement all corrective actions, if they haven't already, and wait for a modified launch license from the FAA before Flight 3 can occur. A summary of the root causes of each vehicle's failure can be seen here. Perhaps the most surprising thing to note for the booster is the source of the explosion. While many believe the FTS is what destroyed B-9, it appears the catastrophic failure of a Raptor engine is what led to the booster's demise. The cause of the series of engine shutdowns was attributed to a blockage of the LOX supply filter. Filtration capability improvements are listed as a corrective action as a result, along with many others. For the ship, Elon had recently revealed that the cause of the ship explosion was a planned LOX dump. With more information now available, the series of events has become more clear. A leak in the aft section of the ship during the planned LOX dump resulted in several fires and explosions, which led to a loss of communication between the flight computers at the top and bottom of the vehicle, triggering engine shutdown and ultimately the flight termination system. Improved fire protection systems, more refined venting operations, and leak reduction efforts were a few of the listed corrective actions. Be sure to check out SpaceX's site for a full rundown of updates provided by the company. And that's it for episode 33 of Starbase Flyover Update. I hope you enjoyed the views. As Flight 3 quickly approaches, Starbase continues to evolve at a rapid pace to support Starship development for returning humans to the moon for the first time in over 50 years. Thank you for choosing to fly with RGV Aerial Photography. If you like what you saw today, please subscribe for more episodes and content so you don't miss out on the new videos each week. I'm Jeff A, and we'll see you next week from 10,500 feet.